This video is sponsored by Nebula. This tends to be a quiet place.
One.
But down on Earth, space has never just been about discovery. It's always been about competition too.
How awesome it will be to have American astronauts plant the flag on another planet.
Whether it's Elon Musk's mission to colonize Mars, or NASA's new moon program, even China is making the headlines. So where is Europe in all of this?
This is Europe's man on the moon moment.
The EU isn't just sitting back on Earth watching Star Trek. It's very much in the space race. And in some areas, it's actually leading the world. We'll explore what the EU is doing in space, how it stacks up against the giants, and what's coming next.
As you see, space will keep us busy.
Now, before we get to all of the fun stuff, you know, rockets, space missions, satellites, let's take a second to explain how Europe is actually set up when it comes to space. Because, as always with the EU, it's not quite as simple as just having one NASA, like in the US. Here's how it works. First, many EU countries have their own national space agencies, focused on research and smaller missions. Germany has the DLR, the German Aerospace Center. France has the CNES, the Centre Nazionale d'Etude Spaziales. Italy has the ASI, the Italian Space Agency. And then there are many more throughout Europe. But when it comes to the big stuff, Mars rovers, scientific satellites, Earth observation, rockets, these agencies usually pool their efforts through the European Space Agency, or in short, ESA. ESA is Europe's main space agency, made up of 23 member states, including three that aren't in the EU: Norway, the UK, and Switzerland. In 2025, the ESA had a budget of about 8 billion euros, and it's the one that's actually building and running Europe's major space missions. Then there's the European Union. The EU mainly funds strategic pan-European space programs and works on legislation to harmonize space activity across all the member states. Now, the ESA is not part of the EU. It's an independent international organization, but the two work very closely together. In fact, the EU is one of ESA's biggest funders, paying for flagship programs like Galileo, Copernicus, and IRIS². About 23% of the ESA's budget now directly comes from the European Commission. Nonetheless, this is a significant budget. Even just looking at the ESA's 8 billion euros alone, it makes it the third largest space agency spender in the world, behind NASA in the United States and CNSA in China, but ahead of Roscosmos in Russia and ISRO in India. And that's not the whole picture, because if you add up all the national space budgets of countries like France, Germany, and Italy, the total European space spending climbs way higher. So how is Europe doing when it comes to actual space capabilities? Let's start with the blockbuster, rockets. Europe's main launcher today is the Ariane 6, developed by the Ariane Group, a joint venture between Airbus and Safran, with contributions from all across Europe. Ariane 6 can carry about 11.5 tons to low Earth orbit and around 4.5 tons to geostationary transfer orbit. Its estimated cost per launch is roughly 100 million euros, and so far it has flown twice, having only just replaced the retired Ariane 5 in July last year. Importantly, there's currently no space capsule designed for manned mission on the Ariane 6, but research for this is ongoing. Now, let's have a look at the competition, especially Elon Musk's SpaceX Falcon 9. Falcon 9 is currently the most frequently launched rocket, with over 499 launches over the last couple of years. It carries nearly 23 tons to low Earth orbit, twice as much as the Ariane 6. Thanks to its reusable first stage, the cost per launch is much lower, around $62 million. Plus, Falcon 9 is crew capable, regularly flying astronauts to the International Space Station. Now, both SpaceX and Ariane have a bigger rocket too. But again, SpaceX edges out Ariane 6, especially as the bigger Ariane 64 has not flown yet. Rockets from China, Russia, and India also compete globally. China's Long March 5 can lift about 25 tons to LEO, with lower launch costs. Russia's Angara A5 offers a similar payload capacity, and India's GSLV MK3 handles about 8 tons. So when it comes to launch vehicles, it's pretty clear. Europe's Ariane 6 is reliable and powerful, but it's facing fierce competition from more cost-effective, higher-frequency rockets from abroad. So, if we had to give it a status, Europe isn't very competitive right now, and is far behind SpaceX, which has reusable rockets, which we'll most likely not see in Europe until the early 2030s. So let's call this red. And this brings us to another key strength the US has over the others, the private sector. SpaceX is a headline name, with reusable rockets and an incredibly high launch frequency. But it's not alone. Companies like Blue Origin, Rocket Lab, Firefly Aerospace, and many others are driving innovation and pushing down costs. But Europe does have a few promising private space startups. Spain's PLD Space is working on the Mura rocket family, and Germany's ISAR Aerospace recently attempted a launch in Norway, though it didn't quite go to plan. But when it comes to components and satellites integration, European engineering is actually quite strong. We design excellent subsystems and sensors. But when it comes to launchers, especially at scale, the US private sector is simply miles ahead. So if we had to give Europe a status here, it's probably dark orange. Another area where the EU is at a disadvantage compared to countries like the US, China, India, or even Russia is coordination. These are single countries with single governments, single rulebooks, and single markets. The EU? Not quite. But that's about to change with the new EU Space Act. Its goal? To create a single market for space activity. One market, one set of rules, with common standards for safety, resilience, and sustainability.
We need to have rules on the road, because we shall have more and more launching systems, more and more satellites in the space. Because space is really bringing to our life a lot of added value.
Let's take safety. Today, there are 11,000 satellites in orbit. By 2050, that number could grow to 50,000. To prevent space from becoming a junkyard, the Space Act pushes for common rules, like requiring satellites to be safely disposed at the end of their life to minimize debris. Then there's resilience. Cyber attacks targeting satellites are rising fast and currently cost the industry over 1 billion euros per year. The EU wants tailored cybersecurity standards for space operators to make the systems more robust. And finally, sustainability. By applying life cycle assessments to space missions, Europe can make its launches cleaner, cheaper, and more efficient, from production to launch to disposal. Therefore, until we create a single market for space, coordination would remain dark orange. Now, next up is an area where Europe truly excels, satellites, starting with navigation satellites, something you probably use every day without knowing. Open Google Maps and satellites will quietly pinpoint your exact location. As of 2025, Europe has 28 Galileo satellites in orbit, and more are planned until full capacity of 30 plus satellites. And they're actually quite spectacular. Galileo offers more precise tracking than any other public system in the world. It can locate you with up to 20 centimeter accuracy, better than the US's GPS or China's Beidou. And unlike GPS, which is run by the US military, Galileo is fully civilian controlled. That gives Europe both independence and reliability in peacetime and in crisis. So when it comes to these type of satellites, Europe is not behind. It's tied, if not ahead, and therefore we give it a green status. Next up, we have communication satellites. These are the systems that beam internet and secure data across the entire globe, especially to remote places where cables and cell towers don't reach. Think Starlink, Elon Musk's satellite internet project, the clear leader in this category, with nearly 8,000 satellites in low Earth orbit, actively providing global broadband service. Right now, Europe does not have its own large-scale broadband satellite network. Yet. But that will change when IRIS2 comes online. It's the EU's upcoming secure satellite internet constellation designed to connect Europe and its neighborhood. But this isn't just about Wi-Fi in the Alps. IRIS2 will provide encrypted communications for governments, emergency services, and eventually military use. The first satellites are expected to launch in 2027, with up to 170 satellites planned in low Earth orbit by 2030. So while the US is still far ahead for now, IRIS2 is Europe's big move to close that gap. Therefore, the status today would be dark orange until this gets online. Next up, Earth observation satellites. Now, Europe's Copernicus program monitors the planet in real time, tracking climate change, natural disasters, agriculture, and pollution. And here, Europe truly shines, as it's the world's most advanced Earth observation system that exists, providing free open data used by scientists, policymakers, and emergency responders. Status, very green. So there you have it. Yes, Europe is behind the US, and even behind China in some areas, but it's very much in the race. And with its economic weight, it can play a serious role in the future of space. This is what I think. I just really hope we don't regulate this to death. Yes, rules obviously matter, but more than anything, we need to start seeing the opportunity, not just the risk. Otherwise, we'll just stand by and watch as our global allies and rivals take the lead, right in front of our eyes. The Space Act is a good start, but I would like to see a lot more quickly. And finally, if we want to be in this game, we have to do it together. No single European country is big enough to compete alone, but the EU, it just might be. It's fascinating to see a new space race forming, and it's not just the EU stepping in. One of my favorite creators, Real Engineering, puts it perfectly.
For decades, space exploration has seemed like a two-player game. The United States and the Soviet Union locked in a battle for dominance beyond Earth. But the landscape has shifted. New players have entered the race, quietly building momentum, challenging the old giants.
And the video just gets better from there on in. It dives into how India in particular is making huge strides. So today it's less of a two-player game and more like five. You can watch the full video on Nebula, today's sponsor, along with more of Real Engineering's excellent work, like their exclusive documentary on the Battle of Britain, a brutal war of attrition that helped turn the tide of World War II. And another great thing is, if you like the originals, you can share them with your friends for free using a guest pass. This kind of high-quality content is exclusive to Nebula, a creator-owned streaming platform built for thoughtful, ad-free storytelling. There are no algorithms pushing clickbait, just smart creators making their best work, like Real Engineering, War Room, and yes, yours truly, EU Made Simple, completely free of ads or sponsorships. Using my link, you can get 40% off your Nebula subscription. There's even a lifetime pass available for just $300. And I say just, because in the long run, it's an incredible deal that will save you a lot of money. Especially as Nebula keeps growing, with new creators and fresh content being added all the time. So go to go.nebula.tv/EUMadeSimple and sign up today. And thank you so much to our presidents, Jan Schauke, Christian Peter, HEVD, Daniel Unite Europe, Stefan, and Mr. Probot. See you in the next video.